The Water is brought to you by Getaway Outdoors, Dive Locker and Scuba Pro, West Coast Siteworks, Camera House and Pentax, and All Boat Business. Welcome to The Water. Today, we're in Dampier, where we'll try to find the three most sought-after mackerel species all in one place. Plus, we'll do an awesome dive. Dampier, the heart of West Australia's mining boom in the Pilbara region, full of people that work hard and play hard, and they like to go fishing. The Red Pilbara Dirt covers the intense mining operations along the coastline of Karratha's sister town, but the Dampier Archipelago offers a stark contrast. Dampier was essentially made by Hammersley Iron to support its enormous iron ore operations, and the people that live there have made the water an important part of their way of life. The archipelago is an important ecosystem, supporting an enormous amount of marine life, and the 42 pristine islands create the sort of water in which you can find one of the most uncommon mackerel. This is one of the few places you can catch broad and narrow-barred Spaniards along with shark macks, and our mission was to find all three, because this is also one of the few places you can get them all in one day. Juddo and his friends from the awesome Nickel Bay Sport Fishing Club suggested that with the howling winds coming from the southwest, our best bet was to head up Flying Foam Passage, which would give us good protection from the howling winds. So, how do you find a broad bar mackerel?
We finally stopped, travelled a fair way, and the moon is just about to touch the horizon in the next couple of hours, which means that the fish are likely to be feeding for about 10 till 2. A lot of run here. There's a saying in the northwest, no run, no fun. I just saw a bait fish launch, so something's after him here. We've got a drop off from the island and a lot of current. So I'm going to use this. This is a Laser Pro, 2.5 metre. Little short lure, so it's like a small bait fish, and it's going to get right down there because it's a deep diver.
Time to troll, and anyone that's done a lot of it will tell you that the best thing to do is to go to sleep and wait for your reel to go off. Unless you're driving, of course. Mind you, you'd like to see at least 15 minutes of life before the dive team passes out. We didn't even have to wait that long.
Whoa, yeah! That's a good start. I was just saying I think it might be a bit early yet, but it isn't early. It's just the right time. This is not a queen fish. This has actually got some weight. And I don't think it's a tuna either. I think we might have an early morning mackerel. Woohoo! Bit of head shake. Ooh, yeah, a bit of surge and head shake. Now you'll notice I'm keeping the rod low and I'm not cranking right up to vertical. I don't want to make the hooks at any point subject to slack line. We're going to lose the fish. Side of the boat. I've got my leader up already. Whoa, it's going under. Going under. What is it? What on earth is it? Come on. Get out from under the boat. Get out from under the boat. Okay, it is a mackerel. It's a good mackerel to start with. How's that for an early morning kickoff?
While it was a nice surprise to ping our target fish less than 10 minutes into the morning session, we'd put ourselves right in the best spot to catch a broad bar. My first fish with the new Finnor Biscayne, I wasn't sure if I liked it yet. Either way, this is when you need your mind on the job, because all mackerel have dangerous teeth and they have a habit of trying to stick you with the lure as well. And after giving the crew a lecture about staying away from hooks and teeth, well, this happened. And it seems that I didn't quite remember to crush all the barbs on that rusty hook. Hospital was over an hour away. so he just ripped it out backwards. Guess he's got a date with a tetanus shot later.
Now, kids, that is why you have barbless hooks, and that is why you don't leave hooks on the deck. That one got me. We'll get cleaned up, we'll get some more fish. That's not going to stop me from fishing. Yep, Skip! We just had a bump on the other lure too. Dave, if you want to grab that one in, I'm going to go high until it's up. I think I might have a queenfish here. It's going under. What is this? What is this? It's silver. The water's just alive with fish at the moment. It's another mackerel. He didn't expect that at all, did you, mate? You thought that was breakfast. Now, this time we're going to be careful with that lure. It's been in my leg, it's been in two fish. The score is 2-1. You should have done that while you're in the water, Tiger.
So we managed to get the second fish back in without sticking anything else into me. And by now, you're probably wondering how you can do this too.
So let's talk about setting up for game fishing in the northwest. The first thing you're going to need probably is an overhead reel. You can do it with a spinning reel, but frankly, you're going to find it a nightmare. In particular, try to use one with a levered drag because it gives you much more control over a fast running fish, and all the fish up here do run fast. That controls the pressure on the fish by using a really high quality drag. Really, 10 to 24 kilo main line is what to aim for. And nothing flash, I've tied a double uni knot just to join the main line to a leader. Leaders are really important. This is a coated mono leader, 80 pounds. And as you can see, it's long, longer than 6 feet, 2 meters long. To that, I've tied a clip swivel, and I've used some pre-made coated wire. Once again, a big long piece. So between the wire and the coated mono leader, there's over 3.5 meters of leader. Now that's because with a big fish at the back of the boat, I can hold on to the leader. It's not gonna break my main line, and it's also not gonna hurt my hands.
Now earlier, you heard me talk about crushed barbs on my hooks, and people will argue that by crushing the barbs, you will lose fish. But I learned the hard way at the Abrolhos Islands during a hot tuna bite why you don't want that barb in your finger.
I got a four-way hook up a yellowfin all over the deck, and I was trying to hold them down when they came on. It was like jackhammering, and I've reached down, and in that thumb there, it's just gone in and to the nail, and the treble's stuck with the barb, and it's jackhammering on the deck. So the first thing we had to do is de-hookify the tuna, and then we tried everything, because we're 2.5 hours out from Geraldton.
You don't want to go back.
Oh, no way. So we tried to cut it out with a knife, and it couldn't cut my thumb. We tried to cut it out with scissors from a Swiss Army knife. We tried to gouge it out, wouldn't come out, eh? So I had to turn around, go all the way back to Geraldton Hospital, 2.5 hours, get there, sit in the waiting room, and then when the doctor came to cut it out, he invited all the interns to laugh at me. And then back out to the Abrolhos that day. I was unthrilled, eh?
Well, maybe he didn't tell them to laugh at me, but they did snigger. So remember, no fish is worth a trip to the hospital or worse. So crush those barbs, especially if there's kids on board.
We're up, Skip. Oh, this is the fish so far. He's still gone the same one. They're really attacking that lure. Oh, he's swimming at me, so it's got to be a mackerel. Always keep that line tight. If they swim at you, chance to go to the gym. Broadbow mackerel are pretty different to most mackerel you're going to see on the show. Not as common by any means. They got a bigger tail. Oh, that's a good one. They got a bigger tail, and they certainly got more power as a result. He's changing directions and cutting back and forth. And of course, as he comes to the back of the boat, remember, keep your feet away. Wow, there's a lot of these fish here. Grab your leader, walk backwards. Feet away from the fish.
We left the broadbar max biting, but the wind was still making it impossible to head into the open ocean to find any other types just yet. But one of the great things about the Dampier Archipelago is the way you can find shelter and current almost everywhere. I had some tsunami soft plastics to try on Trevally, and I knew I'd also find them in the current, but around structure and bommies. This looked like just the place.
There's going to be fun here because we've got an island that's creating a bit of a lee in the current down deep for the fish. I've got myself a red jig head and a tsunami soft tail. The idea is I'm going to send it right up into the air so it sinks fast into that current. And as it comes plummeting down, you might find anything could jump on. Giant trevally, gold spot trevally, goldens, anything. But first, let's try a few jigs and see what happens.
A soft plastic lure is supposed to resemble a bait fish, usually one that's injured. And the best way to get northern species interested is to jig them hard and get everything's attention quickly.
Whoa, yeah, I'm on! Woo, you just come charging off that drop-off. You'll see there's a rock there and a ledge is created. So the bigger fish are going to be sitting under the ledge waiting for something that's bait fish size, like my tsunami, to come wandering through unsuspectingly. And that's exactly what happened. I saw him charge up from the bottom. First time he got that flash of white. High visibility two's the key. And we got ourselves, I think, a gold spot trevally here. Salmon, have a look at that. He's just opened his mouth and gone whoop. No run, no fun. When there's run, there's lots of fun.
Even though trevally are pretty hardy, it's still best to use boga grips to handle and then swim them to make sure they head off in good condition back to the school. Where there's one, there'll be more.
Get on! Oh! Oh, he's come off. You want big, it's all right. Whew, mangled that, have a look. You pull my pants down. Get it back on, get it back up. Now, I'm doing some strange casting here. The current's going that way. So I want to head up current, and I want to go high. High in the air so that the lure has momentum when it hits the ground and it buries deep straight away. Let all that slack line get taken up by the current. And then twitch. There he is. Oh, he's on! I think we might have our first GT. And everything here is pretty big. Now, I have my pants pulled down again. Whew, this one's got some get up and go in the current. But that time, I didn't worry about fixing the lure up because, oh, hang on. Just try and get some control. I didn't fix the lure up because I actually wanted the fish to think it was an injured bait fish and swim more erratically while I was twitching it. And I saw them spinning and spinning and bam, they're on. Oh, in the current, that's as tough as any GT. Up to 6 or 7 kilos. What exciting fishing. It's visual and it's certainly more fun than, well, just about anything.
The wind was dropping and it was almost time to head into the open ocean to try and find shark and Spanish mackerel. But when the soft plastic lures are working, it's pretty hard to stop. Maybe one more.
Oh, I'm on. Oh, man. He's got to get out of that reef. It's so much nasty country under here. I just had a feeling there's so much run around this reef that getting a soft plastic under the boat, oh, trying to talk while getting my arm rearranged, so much reef and so much run that everything's going to be feeding in the current.
And the ledge allows the hunters to sit and save energy to wait for bait fish to wash past.
Bring him over the back of the boat. Whoops, he's in the current now. Not getting out of the prop. Get ready, walk backwards, bring him on. Through the patio door. And folks, that is a gold spot trevally. Very pretty fish. He's just sitting right off that back corner. There's going to be slack water down there, and of course, bait fish. They aren't going to be right out in the open. They're going to be hiding down there, and things like this are going to be ready to whack them. And that's what he thought the tsunami was. He thought it was bait. We'll get him back in the water.
After the break, we'll do an amazing Dampier dive And then we'll try to find two more big mackerel species in the blue water. Want to get your wheels dirty safely? Come and have fun on a Eureka four-wheel drive training course. Professionals train you to deal with any situation in any terrain. Learn how you can get out of a sticky situation with professional guides showing you the ropes. A fun day for the family to learn how to really use your own four-wheel drive.
Oh, Eureka!
And Eureka also do gift vouchers. Call them now.
Whether you're heading up north or escaping down south, we have some great specials for you. Penn Spinfisher 850 for $99. Fantastic bargain. Halco Lures. Buy any two Laser Pro, get one free. CBI Challenger Adult Fin and Snorkel Set, only $59. Boogie Boards from $15. Spirit Torpedo 125 Kayak, $399 with a free paddle. So come on in to get away outdoors.
What's the difference? Well, trolling's what we're doing right now, and trawling's something that you do with a net. Before the break, we were hiding from the wind with Judo and the boys from the Nickel Bay Sport Fishing Club inside the Dampier Archipelago, where we caught broadbarred Spanish mackerel and had the odd mishap. But when the strong winds dropped, we were able to head past the islands and into the cleaner water. Here is where I thought we'd find narrow-barred Spanish and shark mackerel to complete our three species challenge. But while I was off trolling, the dive team, led by Patto, were going to head down along the ledges at the very last island to see just what sort of life you can find in the shallow reefs.
Patto, we're actually staying on Rosemary Road, so I thought I'd bring you to Rosemary Island. And you worked in the Pilbara, in fact, Karratha, for ages, and you've never dived here.
No, I've flown over heaps of times in a helicopter. And often looked out the window and thought, I want to dive there one day, so here we are.
What do you reckon's down there?
I don't know, the reef looks really good. There's a few broken areas, a lot of overhangs. We could see the shadows as we were coming in there, so trout, blue bone, who knows?
You'd think so, but of course, one thing we're going to find out is here, because there's such a population over there, has it really affected the fish species? And I'm going to be really keen to see that. Now, I've got a watch that actually tells me when the fish are feeding. You've got a much bigger watch. What does that do?
This is the Galileo Sol, the biggest and best from Scuba Pro. It's an air-integrated dive computer. It pretty much does everything.
What do you need to know from a dive computer?
From a dive computer, we want to know how warm the water is, our oxygen content in our tanks if we're diving with nitrox or if we're diving with just air. How much air is very important.
Yeah.
Don't want to go running out.
No, I wouldn't think so.
No. Give us our maximum operating depth, and also it's a digital compass.
Wow, so you got everything right at your fingertips.
Everything's right there. It's like one of the old Nokia sort of phones. The buttons up the top there, and it changes the menu.
Can you play Tetris?
Unfortunately not.
All right, well, forget about Tetris. I'm dying to see what's down there, so ditch, mate. Let's see it and stand back, because he's a big boy. It's going to splash.
See you later.
The water here isn't milky coloured. It's clean and blue, but we ran the same lures and the same spread of teasers. And back along the edge of the reef, Patto was finding out that there was an amazing little fish community that most people drive right past.
Hello, I've waited here for you ever long. Tonight, I throw myself into
when I sing along with you.
So that narrow-barred Spanish mackerel meant I had two of my three mackerel species from Dampier. But under the water, Patto was in the middle of one of the best shallow water dives of his life.
So I can breathe you in, hold you in. And now I know you've always been out of your head, out of my head, I say. And I wonder when I sing along with you, if everything could ever feel this real forever, if anything could ever be this good again. The only thing I'll ever ask of you, you gotta promise not to stop when I say.
I think we have mackerel number two. We've got a gap in the islands now. We've trolled along the back of Rosemary, and frankly, there just wasn't a lot of action. So now we've come to a gap where there's a lot of water movement and it's high tide. So now, he's swimming at me. The plan has worked. Oh, still swimming, and that's a mackerel, no doubt about it. Better than the last one. Afternoon sun mackerel, you can't beat that. Oh, that's all right. We're gonna let him go anyway. There's a lot of fish in here. That was a big one. Awesome stuff.
This reef off the back of Rosemary Island is 25 kilometres from shore as the crow flies, and 35 kilometres by boat once you've driven around all of the iron ore rich islands. But it still showed signs of fishing pressure. There were few table fish to speak of, but the micro world was full of thriving ecosystems and sights you can only see as a scuba diver. When Patto surfaced, I could tell he was very surprised about the richness of life clinging to the last shallow water before an open ocean full of the world's most efficient hunters.
I reckon more than any time before, I'm dead keen to ask you, what was that like?
Man, that is an amazing dive.
Really?
More than I expected. The coral's so clean, there's so much of it. Hard corals, soft corals, a couple of big trout. And right at the end of the dive, I have to get you to identify the fish for me, a massive, big, some kind of snapper in a cleaning station. All the little blue wrasse in and out of his gills, cleaning him up. Absolutely amazing. Crystal clear.
Wow, so Rosemary Island is a bit of a surprise then.
Ooh, big time.
The fish Patto was talking about is a type of morwong, often called a sand snapper. But the fish I was more interested in was a shark mackerel, the last of my three species challenge. We moved from the open ocean just a few hundred metres inside the archipelago because there were some pinnacles on the echo sounder that looked like just the place we were likely to find them.
Whoa, there's some good fish! Now with these barbless hooks, it's absolutely vital that this time I keep the pressure on because this feels like the biggest fish of all. We're already past the islands and back in the archipelago. And Mel had been looking at his map all the way, and he said to me, gee, about half a mile up here, there's some shoals that just have mackerel written all over them. Well, he's absolutely spot on.
Now remember, after the leg incident, I'd crushed the barbs on all of the hooks, and this was probably why my last fish got away.
Here he is. It's another mackie. This time, I can't tell what it is yet. Whoa. It's a shark mackerel. That's the one we were thinking we might get. He's taking that little halco, maybe just over the side. But either way, away from the toes. And now in Dampier, we have the three mackerel species. One of the few places you can get all of them. Narrow-barred, broad-barred Spanish, and shark mackerel. That's awesome.
So Dampier really is one of the few places that you can catch the three main species of mackerel on the same day. And thanks to Juddo and the guys from the Nickel Bay Sport Fishing Club, we had a spectacular backdrop to fish against. Perillo is testing the Finnor Biscayne after so many fast-running fish was actually a bonus because of the lightweight design in the end. A danger is that the drag also is made lightweight, but there was no evidence of that here. I'll certainly be using them again for mackies, and I'll make sure that little green laser pro is always in my trolling kit, even if it had spent as much time in me as it was in the mackerel. I hope you enjoyed the first episode of The Water. Next week, we're going to feature the Swan River and cut through all of the myths to show you just how easy it is to catch brim on lures, plus loads more. I hope you can join us. The Water was brought to you by Getaway Outdoors, Dive Locker and Scuba Pro, West Coast Siteworks, Camera House and Pentax, and All Boat Business.